Boards can be defined in any other languages other than Java. So till now we have seen how to define a spout and how to define a bolt and how to create a topology of the spouts and bolts using Java language, right? So now we'll discuss whether bolts can be written in other languages also. Yes, definitely. So bolts can be defined in any other languages. Bolts which are written in another language are executed as sub processes, and Storm communicates with those sub processes with JSON messages over std in or std out. I repeat, bolts can be written in another languages also, and those are executed as sub processes, and Storm communicates with those sub processes with JSON messages over std in, std out. The communication protocol just requires an inline adapter library which automatically ships with Storm, and these libraries are available for Ruby, Python and Fancy. So in my slide I have a small simple example of a split sentence bolt for a word count topology. In my previous slide we have seen split sentence bolt definition for the same word count topology in Java, right? Now we will see how to write the same split sentence bolt in Python. So I have a class here called split sentence which extends from shell bolt and which implements an interface irich bolt. Okay, so now in this constructor split sentence I call a superclass constructor and I pass two parameters to it, saying that I want Python to be used as a language for implementing this particular bolt, and I want split sentence.py which is a concrete implementation of my bolt. And in declare output fields I'm mentioning that the output field of my bolt that I'm emitting, its name is word. So word is the name of a field of the output tuple that I'm planning to emit as an output of this particular bolt. Okay, and here I'm explaining the definition of split sentence.py, which is the concrete implementation of this bolt. So I'm importing a Storm library and then I'm defining class split sentence bolt which takes as a parameter storm.basicBolt so that it inherits the inbuilt functionality of the basic bolt. And I'm defining a process here, okay, and I'm accepting a tuple, and using this tuple I'm saying dot values 0. That means read the value of the first field of this tuple, okay, which is going to be a sentence coming from the spout. So it takes a sentence and it splits with space as a separator. So suppose I get a string, hello world Viraj. Using space I'm splitting that sentence. So how many words will I get? 3 words. Hello, world and Viraj. Correct? So I'm splitting that sentence with a space as a separator or a tokenizer and I'm getting 3 words out of it. For an example sentence, hello world Viraj. And for each of the word in this array of words, I'm emitting that word. That means what this bolt will do is it will take an input sentence and using space as a separator, it will split the sentence into set of words and it will emit each of the word. And this is a methodology to start this particular BOLD, saying split sentence is the class which implements my BOLD definition. So split sentence dot run, that means it will run this particular BOLD. Clear? So this is a simple example of how to write BOLDs in other languages too. Clear? Now we will discuss very important functionality of Apache Store, and that is guaranteeing message processing. Now Apache Storm is a real-time framework, and people will use this framework only when it guarantees that the messages that you give to a Storm is 100% will be processed without any issues, right? So in this context of guaranteed message processing, we'll see what this entire thing means in Apache Storm. The Storm guarantees that each message that is coming off a spout will be fully processed. I repeat, Storm guarantees that each message coming off a spout will be fully processed. This page that I'm going to explain now describes how Storm accomplishes this guarantee and what you have to do as a user to benefit from the Storm's reliable capabilities. So what does it mean for a message to be fully processed? So a tuple that is coming off a spout can trigger thousands of tuples to be created which is based on it. So consider a simple example of a streaming word count topology, wherein sentences are continuously being streamed from the spout, and then we split that sentence into set of words, and then Apache Storm topology finds out how many times each unique word has appeared in the input stream. So this code that I mentioned here is a simple example of the word count topology. So we create a new topology builder. To this builder we do set spout, meaning I am setting a spout for this particular topology whose name is sentences. So name of the spout is sentences. So I am instantiating a new Kestrel spout. Kestrel spout is nothing but a spout who can receive the input data from a Kestrel queue. Just like there is a Kafka messaging system, there is a Kestrel queue as well. So spouts can also read from this Kestrel queue. Okay, so it reads from this, and I'm using string scheme. String scheme meaning it's an encoder which will understand, okay, the data coming from the Kestrel queue only in string format. So string scheme is an encoder that's being used here. Okay, so that means it will only understand the data from the Kestrel queue which is in the string format. Okay, so this is what a spout is. Then I have a bolt here, first bolt whose name is split, and I'm calling new split sentence. So split sentence is a class which will have definition for this split bolt, and I'm connecting to this bolt with a spout using shuffle grouping. So here I am mentioned sentences, right? So this sentences is nothing but the name of this spout. So I am connecting this bolt to this spout with shuffle grouping. That means data from this spout will be randomly distributed to this bolt, task in this bolt. Okay, and then I'm defining another bold whose name is count, and the concrete class implementing this bold is a word count. And I'm connecting this bold with this bold with fields grouping. That means all the tuples with the same value will go to the same task of this bold. So all the tuples coming out from this bold with the same value will be sent to the same task of this bold. So the word hello will always go to a particular task of this bold. A word world will always go to a particular task of this bold. It won't happen that the word hello will go once to task number 1 and next time it will go to task number 2 of this bold. It won't happen anytime. Always when you emit a particular unique word, it will always reside. It will always go to a specific task only of the target bold using fields grouping. Okay, and I'm emitting a tuple whose field name is word, okay, from this bold. So in short, the second bold is just doing counting of each unique words. It will emit how many times each unique word has come in the input sentences. So that's the definition of this particular simple topology. Okay, so just to repeat, this topology reads the sentences of a Kestrel queue. It splits the sentences into constituent words and then emits for each word how many times it has been seen before. So tuple coming off the spout triggers many tuples being created based on it. So tuple for each word in the sentence and a tuple for the updated count for each word. So these are the different tuples which are being created based on the original tuple. So spout will emit a particular tuple which is a sentence. Then a splitter bold will split it into set of words. So all these will be different tuples emitted from your first bold but which are derived from the sentence bold, sentence spout which is emitting the tuple, right? So sentences spout will emit a sentence which is your first tuple. This sentence will go as an input to your split bold. Split bold will split that sentence into words and it will emit set of words as each of the tuples. So this one tuple sentence got converted to each of the words which are emitted by your split bold as its derived tuples. And then from these word tuples which are emitted by your bold split will be given as input to your count bold, right? And this count bold will count how many times each unique word has appeared before and it will emit the count of the each word. So this is how one tuple sentence coming out of this spout got converted in so many tuples along your directed acyclic graph, which is topology, right? Clear? So this single tuple sentence coming out from your spout got converted to set of tuples after it, that sentence has been split, and after each of the words which are being split is sent to a count bold, it will again count how many times that word has appeared before and it will emit the word count. So you just see how this one tuple will get converted into so many output tuples. Correct? So this tree of tuples which I just explained just now is explained here. So let's consider a simple example wherein the initial spout which emits a sentence, let's consider that that sentence is this: the cow jumped over the moon. Let's consider that this is a sentence that is emitted by your spout. So this spout, as soon as it emits this tuple, it goes to your splitter bolt, which will split this sentence into set of words. So the cow jumped over the moon got converted into this. The cow jumped over the moon. So this sentence got split into these words. Who did that? Your splitter bolt. Then output of this splitter bolt is sent to another bolt, which is a counting bolt, right? Which counts how many times so and so word has appeared before. So the, as soon as it is given as input to a counting bolt, till now the has not appeared before. So the comma one, one meaning the has appeared only once in the topology. When cow gets appeared to the counting bolt, cow also has not appeared before. So cow comma one. So cow also has appeared once. Jumped also have not appeared before. So jumped have appeared once. Over has also not appeared before. So over has appeared once. The have appeared before. So the is now two times. Moon have not appeared before, so moon have appeared just once. So this is a diagrammatical format explanation of the word count topology that we have been discussing, right? So a storm considers a tuple coming off a spout as fully processed only when the tuple tree has been exhausted and every message in the tree has been processed. I repeat, storm considers that a tuple coming off a spout is fully processed only when the tuple that has been exhausted, entire tree of the tuple has been exhausted, and every message in the tree has been processed. So only when every message in this entire tree has been processed, storm considers that a tuple coming off this spout is processed. So when each of these nodes is processed, then only storm considers that the initial tuple that is sent from the spout has been fully processed. Is that clear? So even if one of the node is not processed, one of the tuple in this tree is not processed, it doesn't consider that this tuple is processed. Only when the entire tree of tuple is processed, it considers that this tuple that has been emitted is processed. Okay? So tuple is considered filled when tree of messages fails to be fully processed within a specified amount of time. So this timeout can be configured on a topology specific basis using this configuration that I mentioned on my slide. config.topology_message_timeout_seconds. So using topology message timeout seconds, in the configuration file or in the code base, you can configure this timeout. So within this particular time, if the tree of messages are not fully processed, then storm considers that tuple has been failed. Okay, and this configuration is has a default value of 30 seconds. Okay, you can change it. So within this time, if a tree of messages fails to be fully processed, then the tuple is considered to be filled, and then storm replaces the tuple, and this is how it guarantees that the message has been processed. So within this time limit, if the tuple tree is not fully processed, it considers that that tuple has failed, and storm replaces the tuple so that it gets processed again. Okay, this is how it guarantees that the tuple has been processed. Clear? Now what happens if a message is fully processed or fails to be fully processed? To understand this question, let's take a look at the life cycle of a tuple that is coming off a spout. So here is an interface that spout implements. So I have an interface iSpout which extends serializable. Okay. So first, storm requests a tuple from a spout by calling the next tuple method. First, storm requests for a tuple from the spout by calling next tuple method of the spout. So the spout uses the spout output collector method that is provided in the open method of it to emit a tuple to one of its output strings. When emitting a tuple, spout provides a message ID that will be used to identify this tuple later. For example, if you are using a Kestrel spout which reads a message of a Kestrel queue and emits as a message ID the ID which is provided by the Kestrel for the message. Emitting a message to spout output collector looks like this. So I'm emitting new values with field 1, field 2 as the name of the headers to the tuples. And this message ID is given by the Kestrel queue. Okay, so this is how Kestrel spout will look when it is emitting its tuple with message ID as the ID given by the Kestrel queue. Okay, now next, the tuple gets sent to a consuming bolts, and storm takes care of tracking the tree of messages that is created. If storm detects that a tuple is fully processed, storm itself will call the ACK method on the originating spout task with a message ID that a spout has provided to the storm. I repeat, if a storm detects that the tuple that is emitted by a spout is fully processed, storm will call ACK method on the originating spout task with a message ID that the spout has provided to storm. Likewise, if the tuple times out, storm will call fail method on the spout. Understanding? So if the tuple is successfully processed, it calls ACK method. If tuple is failed, it calls fail method on the spout. Note that a tuple will be ACKed or failed by the exact same spout task that created it. I repeat, the tuple will be ACKed or failed by exact same spout task that created it. So if a spout is executing as many tasks across the cluster, a tuple won't be acknowledged or failed by a different task other than the one that created it. So it is fascinating. So if the spout is executing many tasks across the cluster, a tuple won't be acknowledged or failed by a different task other than the task that created that particular tuple. Understand? Now let's move on to what is Storm's Reliability API. There are two things you have to do as a user to be benefited from Storm's reliability capabilities. First, you need to tell the Storm whenever you are creating a new link in the tree of tuples. And second, you need to tell Storm when you have finished processing an individual tuple. I repeat, there are two things that you need to do as a user to benefit from Storm's reliability features. And what are those? First is, you need to tell Storm whenever you are creating a new link in the tree of tuples. And second, you need to tell Storm when you have finished processing an individual tuple. By doing both of these things, Storm can detect when the tree of tuples is fully processed and can acknowledge or fill the spout tuple appropriately. Storm's API provides a concise way of doing both of these tasks. Specifying a link in the tuple tree is called anchoring. Okay? So I had given you all example of this tuple tree, right? Each of these are called links. And specifying these links in a tuple tree is called anchoring. Okay? So anchoring is done at the same time when you emit a new tuple. So let's use the following example on my slide to discuss it further. So this bolt splits a tuple containing a sentence into tuple for each word. So it is just a simple split sentence which extends from basic reach bolt. So it's a bolt implementation, split sentence, which will just take an input sentence and it will split into set of words. So I have an output collector defined here. In the prepare method, whatever collector object I'm getting, I'm setting it to the data member collector. And in the execute method, which is actually invoked while emitting a tuple, what am I doing? I'm getting a tuple as an input from the spout, and using getString of 0, I'm reading the value of that sentence. Then using for loop, I'm splitting this sentence into set of words with space as a delimiter. So I'm getting each word in this particular for loop. So as soon as I get each word, I emit that whose column name is word. And then I'm calling ack method as soon as all the words are successfully emitted. So there's a for loop which keeps on emitting each word that I get after splitting the input sentence. And as soon as I emit all the words, I call ack method. And in declare output fields, I need to define the name of the field of the output tuple that I'm emitting, and that's word. Word is a name given to a column of the output tuple that I'm emitting here. Okay, so that's an explanation to this particular code that I have on my screen here. Okay, so here each word tuple is anchored by specifying the input tuple as the first argument to emit. Now this is the emit method, right, which emits the set of words. So each word tuple here is anchored by specifying the input tuple. Input tuple is this, right? By specifying the input tuple as the first argument to emit. Since the word tuple is anchored now, the spout tuple at the root of the tree will be replayed later on if the word tuple fields to be processed downstream. I repeat, since the word tuple is anchored now, because this word tuple has been connected, because we are passing this, what is this tuple? This is the input sentence tuple, right? And to the emit, we pass this input sentence tuple as the first parameter. That means we do anchoring, we define the links between this sentence and set of words that we are emitting now. So since the word tuple is anchored, the spout tuple at the root of the tree will be replayed later on if the word tuple fails to be processed downstream. In contrast, let's look at what happens if the word tuple emitted is like this. What if we emit a word and we don't pass the incoming tuple as the first argument to the emit? What happens now? Now, emitting the word tuple this way causes it to be unanchored. That means here we are not connecting the input sentence with the word tuple that we are emitting. So what happens now? So emitting the word tuple this way causes it to be unanchored. So if a tuple fails to be processed downstream, the root tuple will not be replayed. I repeat, if we define tuples this way, if we emit the tuples this way as unanchored, and if the tuple fails to be processed downstream, the root tuple will not be replayed. Depending on the fault tolerance guarantees you need in your topology, sometimes it's appropriate to emit an unanchored tuple. So depending on what fault tolerance you are planning to accept in your topology, sometimes it's appropriate to emit an unanchored tuple, because basically there will be a data loss here if a particular tuple is not being replayed if it fails. But on the other side, you will get a speed out of it. The performance will be faster. With anchoring and with replaying of tuples, the performance is a bit impacted in a butter storm, but there is reliability. But if you want to make your systems wherein you do have some fault tolerance and you can allow some tuples to be failed and not reprocessed, and if you want high speed, then you can use this method of unanchoring, wherein if any tuple fails, it's not going to be replayed, but you are getting the higher performance out of this particular implementation. Okay. So an output tuple can be anchored to more than one input tuple. Fascinating, right? An output tuple can be anchored to more than one input tuple. This is useful when you are doing streaming joins or aggregations. So multi-anchored tuple failing to be processed will cause multiple tuples to be replayed from the spouts. I repeat, a multi-anchored tuple failing to be processed will cause multiple tuples to be replayed from the spout. Multi-anchoring is done by specifying a list of tuples rather than just a single tuple, because the example that I've shown in my previous slide, it was just a one-to-one mapping. One tuple was connected to one previous tuple. In multi-anchoring means current tuple is connected to more than one input tuples. So if this current tuple fails, more than one tuple will be replayed. Correct? And hence, multi-anchoring needs to be done by specifying list of tuples rather than a single tuple. So here I have given a small example of how to do that. So I create an array list of tuples, okay, and in this anchors I add tuple 1, tuple 2, okay, and when I'm emitting a current tuple, to that I'm passing anchors here. What did I pass in my previous example? In this simple example, I was emitting a word and I am defining an anchoring by passing a single tuple to it. This was a single tuple. So this word that I was emitting, I was anchoring it to a single tuple. I repeat, this word that I was emitting, I was anchoring it to a single tuple. Whereas now in multi-anchoring example, this tuple that I'm emitting, I'm connecting it to a list of tuples. Because what is anchors? Anchors is a list of tuples. So this word that I'm emitting, I'm connecting it to a list of input tuples. So I'm defining anchoring by connecting this output tuple with more than one input tuples. I repeat, I'm defining this anchoring by connecting this output tuple with more than one input tuple. That's why it is multi-anchoring. So if this tuple fails, Storm has to replay all the tuples in anchors. Understood? So multi-anchoring adds the output tuple into multiple tuple trees. So this Storm's implementation works for DAGs as well as trees. Okay? Anchoring is how you specify the tuple tree. So here in this example, D has been multi-anchored. How? Because B is connecting to D, C is connecting to D. So if I just connect this diagram with this example, this output tuple that I'm emitting, you can consider it to be D, and list of anchors you can consider as B and C. Alright? So next and final piece of Storm's reliability API is specifying when you have finished processing an individual tuple in a tree. This is done by using either a ACK or a fail method of output collector. If you look back at the split sentence example, you can see that input tuple is ACKed after all the word tuples are emitted. We'll just go to that example again. See here. Input tuple that we receive is ACKed only when all the words generated from this bolt is successfully emitted. That's why it is placed outside the for loop. Right? So you can use the fail method on the output collector to immediately fail the spout tuple at the root of the tuple tree. For example, your application may choose to catch an exception from the database client and explicitly fail the input tuple. By failing the tuple explicitly, the spout tuple can be replayed faster than if you waited for the tuple to time out. So it's up to you how you implement the stuff, right? Every tuple that you process must be acknowledged or failed. Storm uses memory to track each tuple. So if you don't acknowledge or fail every tuple, the task will eventually run out of memory. So a lot of bolts follow a common pattern of reading an input tuple, emitting tuples based on it, and then ACKing the tuple at the end of the execute method, just like how we did in the previous example. So these bolts fall into a categories of filters and simple functions. The Storm has an interface called basic bolt that encapsulates this pattern for you. This is fascinating. Instead of you yourself implementing the ACK and FAIL methods, Storm has provided an inbuilt interface for you called Basic Bolt that encapsulates this pattern of ACKing and calling FAIL method for you. So the split sentence example that we have seen before can be rewritten using the Basic Bolt class as follows. So what are we doing here? In execute method, we read the sentence from the incoming tuple, then we split it and we just emit it. We don't even call ACK method. And in the declare output fields method, we just declare the name of the field of the output tuple that we are emitting. We are not ACKing outside the for loop. That is because we extend from Basic Bolt, and that class has an inbuilt functionality of ACKing or calling FAIL method for us. Correct? So this implementation is simpler than the implementation before and is semantically identical. So tuples which are emitted to Basic Output Collector are automatically anchored to the input tuple. Understanding? So in this implementation, the tuples which are emitted to the Basic Output Collector are automatically anchored to the input tuple, and the input tuple is acknowledged for you automatically when the execute method completes. Wow, that is awesome. Input tuple is automatically acknowledged for you when this execute method completes successfully. In contrast, the bolts that do aggregations or joins may delay ACKing a tuple until after it has computed a result based on the bunch of tuples. So aggregations and joins will commonly multi-anchor the output tuples as well. Okay, so these complex things fall outside the simpler pattern of Basic Bolt. So understood this Basic Bolt, it automatically provides you the ACKing feature and anchoring feature for you. If you extend your Bolt implementation from the Basic Bolt here. So now how do I make my applications work correctly given that tuples can be replayed? Because it should not be that a particular tuple is processed two times in my topology. I want each tuple to be processed exactly once. For that, Storm has given you transactional topologies. Okay? So Storm does a guaranteed data processing by providing an at least once processing guarantee. So the most common question that is asked about the Storm is, given that Storm can replay the tuples, how do you do things like counting on top of Storm, because you don't want to overcount. Hence Storm includes something called transactional topologies which enable you to get exactly once messaging semantics for pretty much any computation. So you can do things like counting in a fully accurate, scalable and fault tolerant way. So just like your distributed RPC, transactional topologies aren't so much a feature of a Storm, as they are higher level abstractions which are built on top of Storm's primitive components like spouts, streams, bolts and topologies. So transaction topologies is a higher level abstraction which is developed on streams, spouts, bolts and topologies. Okay, so Let's discuss the different designs which are involved in transactional topologies. So let's start by looking at the simplest possible approach, and then we'll reiterate over the design until we reach the Storm's design. So let's try to discuss design number one. So the core idea behind transactional topologies is to provide a strong ordering on the processing of data. Ordering is important. The simplest manifestation of this and the first design we look at is processing the tuples one at a time and not moving on to the next tuple until the current tuple has been fully processed by the topology. So we are just planning to process one tuple at a time and we are not moving on to the next tuple until the current tuple is complete. So each tuple is associated with it a transaction ID. If the tuple fails and needs to be replayed, then it is emitted with exact same transaction ID. A transaction ID is an integer that increments for every tuple. So the first tuple will have transaction ID 1, second tuple will have transaction ID 2, and so on. So the strong ordering of tuples gives you the capability to achieve exactly one semantics even in the case of tuple replay, because for each tuple we have unique ID. So let's look at an example of how you could do this. Suppose you want to do a global counting mechanism of tuples in the input string that's coming in. So instead of storing just the count in the database, you could instead store the count and the latest transaction ID together as one value in the database. So when your code updates the count in the DB, it should update the count only if the transaction ID in the database differs from the transaction ID for the tuple that is currently being processed. Okay, so let's consider the two cases. First case, the transaction ID in the database is different than the current transaction ID. This is because of the strong ordering of transactions. We know for sure that the current tuple isn't represented in that count. So we can safely increment the count and update the transaction ID in the DB now, right? Second use case is, what if the transaction ID is the same as the current transaction ID? What is the transaction ID in the DB is same as your current transaction ID? So then we know that this tuple is already been incorporated into count in the DB and we can skip the update. The tuple must have failed after updating the DB but before reporting the success to the Storm. That's why it was not being reflected. So it was, the count was already incremented in the DB but before telling the Storm that it is success, it failed later. So it was replayed. But now before updating we do check, right, that transaction ID has to be different. But transaction ID of the current tuple is same as the transaction ID in the DB. That proves that this count is already updated in the DB. So we not have to re-update in the DB. So that will, this will ensure that this tuple is processed exactly once as far as updating the count in DB goes. Right? So this logic and the strong ordering of transaction ensures that the count in the DB will be accurate even if tuples are replayed. Correct? So this is your design one. But there is a significant problem with this design of processing one tuple at a time. And what is that? Having to wait for each tuple to be completely processed before moving on to the next tuple is inefficient. It results in huge amount of database calls, one per tuple, and this design makes very little use of parallelization capabilities that a Storm has. And hence, this design one is not scalable. Hence, let's think whether we can optimize design one and get design two out of it. So instead of processing one tuple at a time, a better approach is to process a batch of tuples for each transaction. So if you are doing a global count, you will increment the count by the number of tuples in the entire batch. So if a batch fails, you replay the entire exact batch that failed. So instead of assigning a transaction ID to each tuple, you will assign a transaction ID to each batch. And the processing of batches is strongly ordered. So here is the diagram of this particular design. So I have a transactional spout which keeps on emitting tuples. So if you are processing 1000 tuples per batch, your application will do 1000 times lesser database operations than your design one. Additionally, it takes an advantage of Storm's parallelization capabilities, as the computation for each batch can be parallel, right? So in this batch, there are 1000 tuples. So all 1000 tuples can be parallelly processed at the same time. So we can make use of the parallelization capabilities of the Storm here. Right? So this transactional spout emits batches of tuples and then it's given to birds for processing. So while this design is significantly better than your design one, it's still not as resource efficient as possible, because the workers in the topology spend a lot of time for being idle, waiting for other portions of computations to finish. For example, in the topology like this, a spout is emitting to a bolt 1, then it goes to bolt 2, then it goes to bolt 3, then it goes to bolt 4. After your bolt 1 finishes its portion of processing, it will be idle until the rest of the bolts finish and the next batch is emitted from the spout. Correct? So as soon as bolt 1 is done with its task, it has to simply wait idle till bolt 2, 3 and 4 computes its processing, because only then your next batch will come for processing. Correct? Hence, let's think about design 3 as a more optimal way, and which is the Storm's design. Right? See, we started from a scratch, we kept on trying to improvise the design, and now we are reaching on the design 3, which is in fact a Storm's design. What's that? So key realization is that not all the work of processing batch of tuples needs to be strongly ordered. For example, when computing a global count, there's two parts to the computation. First is computing the partial count for the batch and updating the global count in the DB with the partial count. So computation of updating the global count in a DB needs to be strongly ordered across batches. But there is no reason why you should not be able to pipeline the computation of the batches by computing the partial count within the batches in parallel. So within the batches, computing its own partial counts can go parallel. But updating in DB has to be strongly ordered. So while your batch 1 is working on updating the DB, batches 2 till batches 10 can compute their partial counts, that is counts within their batches. Fascinating, right? So your updating stuff in the main DB needs to be strongly ordered and one at a time. but your partial counting within batches can go parallel. So Stomp accomplishes this distinction of breaking the computation of a batches into two phases. First is the processing phase. This is a phase that can be done in parallel for many batches. And second is the commit phase. The commit phase for batches are strongly ordered. So the commit for batch 2 is not done until commit for batch 1 is fully successful. I repeat, the commit for batch 2 is not done until a commit for batch 1 is successful. So these two phases together is called a transaction. Many batches can be in the processing phase at a given moment, but only one batch can be in the commit phase. If there is any failure in the processing or commit phase of a batch, the entire transaction, that is its both phases, is replayed. Okay, so let's discuss more on this in upcoming presentation. Thank you.